Now on Chronicle.
Having a job and the mail was good.
History redefined. The textile industry reigned supreme in South Carolina.
It's hard to imagine South Carolina without the textile mill. I mean, it was just that important.
So we just kind of was a big family. You knew everybody.
But then the industry changed forever.
And you start pulling one thread out, it all starts falling apart.
The dawn of a new age in the Carolinas.
We're reweaving the neighborhood back together.
Shaped by a rich history.
We wanted to recreate the community that once existed here.
With renovation and work ethic.
A lot of people don't realize, especially newcomers.
And now, Chronicle, remaking the mills.
Welcome to Chronicle. I'm Jane Robillow. Textiles helped shape the landscape of the upstate that we treasure today. And so many aspects of that way of life are still ingrained in the fabric of our culture today. Many of these brick buildings, like here at Drayton Mill with their sturdy wood floors, once spun and wove around the clock. And they've now been transformed into beautiful loft apartments with swimming pools and cafes. In this next hour, we'll take you back in time to explore life on the mill hill, the dark period when many mills closed and thousands lost their jobs, and how textiles have found a new future in South Carolina. Nigel Robertson begins our journey.
Textile mills. They were and still are woven into the story of the Carolinas.
A lot of people don't realize, especially newcomers.
After all, it would be hard to. Today, you will find these expensive, high-end condos with towering ceilings and shiny old hardwood floors dotted all over the upstate. But the footprint they create first created what many consider the textile capital of the world.
We estimate that U.S. consumer will touch a Millikan product 30 to 50 times a day.
But before textiles became a foundational part of the technology of today, it was simply the fabric of the past. Cotton, yarn, and wool were transformed into clothing here at Millikan and at other textile mills all over the area.
Textiles is very much alive and well here in the upstate of South Carolina.
Millikan was and still is one of the biggest names in the textile world.
Is creating, and textiles is our canvas.
So inspiration for us came from bubble wrap.
A canvas that today is global.
In Mexico, in Europe, and also in India and in China.
But not all textile mills were able to adapt like Millikan.
And it's really hard to face that as a community when you see that mill close. Like, where is everyone going to go?
The once flourishing textile industry that created jobs, grew communities, and gave families the foundation they needed to build generational wealth began to literally disappear.
So a lot of mills closed because of that. It was just cheaper to produce the textiles somewhere else.
Innovation made it so fewer people were needed. Globalization took jobs too. It simply became cheaper for textiles to be made elsewhere.
In the 70s, you started to see the slide.
Some survived, many didn't. And that brings us back to what was left. Massive former textile mills, some still standing, finding new life again.
Agribusiness is South Carolina's number one industry, and cotton is still a top commodity. But in the mid-1800s, William Gregg introduced the idea of spinning instead of just shipping that cotton. Gabrielle Komorowski takes us to the town of Graniteville to show us that what happened in that Aiken County town would transform the South.
Valuable, plentiful. It would eventually earn a royal nickname in the South.
King Cotton, as it was called.
Joanne Zeiss, the curator of history at the South Carolina State Museum in Columbia, says cotton production in South Carolina was booming in the 1800s, before the Civil War, harvested primarily by slaves. Census data shows more than 61 million pounds of lint cotton were produced in 1840. That amount would more than double by 1850.
Cotton reigned supreme in South Carolina.
But South Carolina did not hold on to most of it. The cotton was shipped primarily to the north.
Those goods are being processed in bolts of cloth, in clothing, in linen, and then coming back to the south, and we're being charged double, triple, quadruple the price.
In 1845, a capitalist named William Gregg, who'd visited successful textile mills in the north, wanted to bring that industry to South Carolina, writing, "Surely there is nothing in cotton spinning that can poison the atmosphere of South Carolina. Why not spin as well as plant cotton?"
He knew exactly where to come.
William Gregg chose a part of Aiken County that's now called Graniteville. Archaeologist George Wingard says this area had an important feature.
Running through the town was a canal, so Gregg knew there was already a power source here, that power being hydro.
With the power source in place for the granite mill, a village around the mill was built for the workforce, with a school, two churches, a park. Workers were given homes.
They built what was known as Blue Row, about 40 workers' cottages.
William Gregg promised white families with little money who had been working on farms a more comfortable life.
So Gregg right there felt, he was like, hey, this is a help. We're getting you out of the fields. You're going to get a stable paycheck. You get to go home. You know, you don't have to worry about the intricacies of, you know, are you going to be fed next month? You're going to be able to put kid clothes on your kids' backs because you're going to be making a paycheck. You're going to be working for me, but you're going to be making a paycheck.
The granite mill opened in 1847 and kept operating during the Civil War.
This mill was phenomenally successful, phenomenally successful.
William Gregg's formula for the granite mill and the village surrounding the mill were considered so successful, Graniteville would become a blueprint for other textile mill villages throughout the Southeast.
It isn't until after the Civil War, so all of that destruction and the state trying to find new ways to make money in the 1880s. There's still a lot of money from some of those old families, and they're trying to diversify. So they see a great opportunity in starting those mills.
And like William Gregg nearly 40 years earlier, those southern business owners in the 1880s looked for places that had the right ingredients and found a recipe for success in the upstate.
Cotton is mostly going to be grown then in the upstate.
Water to power the mills and
towns on railroads, Greenville, Spartanburg, even the smaller ones like Ware Shoals near a railroad. All of that plays in. So you can get the cotton in, you can get the textiles out. One of the things the upstate also had at that time was a lot of labor. So you had people who, in all the unrest after the Civil War, you had a lot of people who needed work rather desperately. So it was cheap labor.
By the year 1883, there were 27 textile mills in South Carolina. That would grow to 169 mills by the year 1909, with more than half in the upstate. William Gregg's vision of bringing commercial cotton spinning to the South would help to move South Carolina into a new era as a global textile leader.
With a new industry to spin its cotton, textile mill fever spread through South Carolina. And as Stephanie Trotter shows us, during most of the 20th century, that success grew to worldwide prominence.
The melody of millions of spindles reverberated across the Southeast heading into the 1900s. During the first decade, employment at South Carolina's mills jumped 47%. In many towns and villages, the livelihood of more than half the population was woven into textiles. Historian Paul Grady.
They just took off running. At the turn of the century, it was so explosive that it was catching the attention of Northerners.
The New York Times called Spartanburg the Lowell of the South, a reference to the Massachusetts textile town that was one of the largest industrial cities in the world.
By 1910, Spartanburg County had more mills than anywhere else in the state, 37, including Appalach Mill right behind me. They employed some 8,000 operatives, as they're called. Men, women, and children as young as 10, 12 if they work the night shift. Prior to labor laws, these weaving wonders would work up to 72 hours a week, making 5 to 10 cents an hour.
By the mid to late teens, mill operations started hitting snags, creating highs and lows like a short pattern repeat. Don Kuntz studied the industry for 8 years to direct building an empire.
One minute they were doing fabulous. They were making money hand over fist. the next minute they were practically out of business. And the reason is because of the wars.
Before both world wars, industry numbers dropped. The mills couldn't get needed dyes and machinery from Germany. During each war, production numbers rose. During World War II, women and African Americans made military-grade fabric for troops, tents, and uniforms. After the wars, a drop again due to surplus. And in between, the Depression delivered a big dip, demonstrating the delicate balance of supply and demand, manpower, and cotton prices.
The textile industry, not just in Greenville, but everywhere, was like a roller coaster.
During that time, across booms and busts, South Carolina eclipsed New England in manufacturing. And while Spartanburg led the state in operations, Greenville led in ownership. 56 mill presidents called Greenville home, with banks and purchasing offices that fed 10% of supplies for the entire industry, including the textile crescent.
Greenville certainly is growing. We're bursting at the seams.
NBC showcased how the region was dressing the nation, spinning and weaving more than half of the country's clothing. Apparel and finishing facilities now stood alongside the original cotton mills. By the mid-50s, Greenville called itself the textile center of the South, and folks from as far away as Asia came calling to the Southern Textile Exposition, which had started in 1915. Some years, so many visitors attended, neighbors rented out beds when the city ran out of hotel rooms.
And by 1963, they built the Palmetto Expo Center, which was they called Textile Hall, and it was huge. It was one of the largest textile expositions in the world.
Just down I-85, a new, bigger airport opened, creating a portal for Greenville to declare itself the undisputed textile center of the world.
If you were in the textile industry, or if you were in the garment industry, or if you were in any way related to anything that needed that, common guy might not know the upstate of South Carolina, but industrial leaders did, because that's where they went to get their product.
In the Palmetto State, the industry peaked in the mid-70s, with 437 mills employing more than 143,000 workers. By then, products started changing, and plants were continually forced to modernize.
It looks great, but there's danger ahead for those that were paying attention.
Even knotted thread won't stop the unraveling of the mill era to come.
It was hard work, but it was rewarding.
Next on Chronicle, an up-close look at life on the mill hill.